Okay,
Yeah.
so Pete, how long have we known each other? We've been you came on, I met you on a workshop that I did with David Duchemin back in like
Yeah.
2008 or 9, something like that, right?
I think 9 or 10, something. Yeah, I think 9, probably. Yeah. So
Yeah.
11 years.
So about 11 years. Okay. And well, there's George Neal is there. He's saying it's well enough. Sounds great.
Yeah, and
Okay, now it's great.
Renee is
Everybody
happy
likes it
too,
now.
so yeah.
So, okay.
All
Good.
right.
All right. So anyway, so we've known each other for about 9, no, 10, 11 years, right? 10, if
Yeah.
it was 2009, it's 2020, so 11 years. And in that time, when we first met, you used to you had just really gotten into, you were still shooting Nikon, I believe, and
Yeah.
you had just finished traveling around the world taking pictures. You went to Indonesia and Iran and places like that, right?
Yeah,
And
right.
you had not, I don't think at that point you had written any ebooks or done anything like that, right?
No, that started after that trip where I met David and you. Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, so it was after that you started writing ebooks and you started writing Lightroom ebooks and then you started writing more Lightroom ebooks. How many by now, how many Lightroom ebooks have you written? 10?
I think about 10, something like that. Yeah, like Lightroom 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So that's already 5. And then a couple of those, both in Dutch and in English. So I think, yeah, close to 10, probably. Yeah.
So yeah, so
And
you've
then there was the
been.
flash books and, yeah.
That's right, that's right. And you've done a street photography book. You've done a book on lighting and on travel photography. So you're a prolific author. You have both.
And I'm working on one on travel, yeah, but that
Yeah.
one got postponed a bit. Yeah.
So you've been you've but you've these aren't just ebooks either. You've got some what do you call it? Paper books. Right?
Sorry, you broke up there for a second.
Okay, I said you actually have like paper books. I mean, physical books.
Real like the kind you get in a library and stuff. Absolutely.
Right.
I've been working with publishers, but then one of them got bankrupted, and then so I lost a lot of money on that, and then I decided I would just be my own publisher, and so I've self-published all the recent ebooks and the print books as well. So I just I have a printer and a layouter, and I just think, if you do it yourself, you can do it better. So, yeah, it's been fun so far.
Now, when did you get into, I mean, one of the things that I think I know you about, I mean, to me, when I think of Pete, I think of Lightroom and I think of lighting, I think of off-camera lighting and then of course, travel imagery. But off-camera lighting, when was it that you started really getting into that? I mean, you
Well,
did that even on your trip around the
I
world,
think
right?
also about at this, yeah, right. So it must be also about 10 years ago, I think. The funny thing is, I have a classical, education. I took photography as in an evening course in the Academy of Fine Arts, and we had studio lighting there, but I never really understood it very well because that was in the analog days still, and so it was like a week between you taking a shot and then you seeing the result in the contacts, and then by then I had forgotten what I had done wrong in the first place, and then it was only with the advent of digital that I really it sunk in a little bit, and I remember even flying to Bristol to a workshop by Damien Lovegrove, and that kind of got me jump started, and I've been playing around with it ever since. It's a bit technical, and I'm a bit of a techie geeky guy, so it appealed to my technical brain, and also I like the results it gets because it's very aesthetical as well, and that's I like the combination of both.
I was talking with photographer this morning who's going to be, I'll be interviewing him next week. We were talking about lighting, and he was saying, yeah, I don't travel with any lights at all. But he said, I may have to start because I like your stuff. I've been looking at your imagery with all the lights and everything. He says, it's amazing. It doesn't look like it's lit, you know? And I laughed at that, and I said, well, actually, you know, that all that credit goes to my buddy Pete, because he's been sort of my mentor when it comes to lighting. You laugh, it's true. I hated lighting. My idea of lighting was, you know, find a window.
I still remember when you literally you were struck by off-camera lighting. It was in an alleyway very close to our hotel in Varanasi, and you already by then you kind of understood that if the lighting outside is really crappy, like if it's bright sunlight, that, you know, flash can really have an advantage because you can control the direction and everything. But then you wanted to show me that in like a shady alleyway, that, you know, available light was just as good. And I remember you setting up this great looking guy, and you did a shot with available light, and it was nice. It was soft Rembrandt-ish light on him. And then I set up the flash, and you took the same shot, but with a softbox and a flash in that shaded area. So technically there was no reason to use flash because light was soft and nice as it was. But I still used the flash anyway. And you did both. I think you even did a blog post on that, and you compared it, and I still remember your reaction. And from that day on, I knew you were hooked to the drug of camera lighting. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that is, it's true. I just a second here. I actually used that exact story when I teach on not just lighting, but just when I've been teaching, because it was a profound moment, I guess, because I think for me, the thing that I learned from that moment was that, yes, available light is good, and an available light can be amazing, and I still shoot available light. In fact, you and I just got back from Kolkata back in January, and I did a lot of available light there using the X100 V, and they were stunning. Some of the best work I've done in a long time. But one of the things that I've noticed over the years is, and this is the thing that you pointed out to me at that moment, at that instance that we were talking about, was how what the light can do is it can actually, especially if you have it raking across the person, the fabric, the wall, whatever, it creates texture much more than what, you know, available light would do, because available light can, I guess the shadows are softer, things like this, you know, and ever since then, I use a picture of that instance, the picture that we took with the flash, and a picture that we took with the available light, and I put them side by side and show the difference in the texture between his shawl, his, you know, everything like that. So it's amazing. So yeah, that was a that was an aha moment for me, and so we've been doing workshops now. Most of them have been lighting workshops ever since, since before that instant. But tonight, one of the things we want to do is, because you are an expert at Lightroom, and because you've written so many books on Lightroom, we're actually going to have a time where, if you have a question about Lightroom, you people that are listening, and we have a whole bunch of people listening already, and it's good to see so many friends, people have gone on workshops with us, other people that are already listening. I want you to drop a question in that you have about Lightroom, and you can actually we'll ask Pete, we'll drop the question right in, and we will see if he can answer it. And we're going to call this segment Stump the Expert. And I don't know, we don't have a prize for if they stump you, do we? I don't think we do. We should come up with something offhand. I don't think he was going to be able to stump you, so we'll see. I'll buy him a beer the next time I see him or something. I don't know. So yeah. we got a question here, or actually a statement. It says Marcia Leavetown. Sorry, I'm sorry if I mispronounced your name wrong. Says, can you? Oops, sorry, went off too quick. Can you share those photos in a new blog post again for us? Yeah, I can do that. In fact, I was actually trying to pull up the. I have them in a keynote, and I was trying to pull them up while we were talking, and that's why I was like, I actually opened up the wrong app. So there's right now I've got like literally 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, like 8 windows that I'm looking at right now. So it's a little. I think we do good just to stick on topic right now. So anyway, so if you have a question, go ahead and ask Pete. Well, actually, we got one right now. Chester wants to know, do you use LUTs with Lightroom? I don't know why you would use
wow, that's already
LUTs. LUTs is usually used in video. Can you use LUTs with Lightroom, Pete?
Yeah, you can. You really? Can.
How does that work?
Yeah, sorry, Chester, no prize for you because I know the answer to that one. Wow. But so you can use LUTs, but the trick is you have to create them in Adobe Photoshop or in any other app. You have to basically create a cube file, and then you can include a cube LUT file in a creative profile, and that you can then use in Lightroom. So you cannot natively directly, like if you have a LUT from a video app, use it directly in Lightroom, but you can incorporate it as one of the grading elements in a creative profile, and then you can use it along with other elements like clarity and shadows adjustments and whatnot, and then you can package that into a creative profile and then use it in Lightroom and in Camera Raw. Yeah, it's fun. It's fun, but it's also quite technical. So I could do like I would need a full hour probably to explain the whole workflow of how that goes, and it's probably too techy for most people. Yeah, but we could do another Facebook Live maybe.
Wow. I mean, I'm shocked. I didn't know anything about using LUTs in Lightroom.
The new creative profiles are amazing. It's like they're like presets on steroids. I've got a couple of packs of my own. I have two of these packs, and the nice thing is that they can, you know, a Lightroom preset can only, you know, is basically a shortcut to slider settings in Lightroom, but a Lightroom preset cannot give your image a special look that you couldn't achieve just by putting the presets anywhere in Lightroom. I mean, Lightroom presets don't extend the possibilities of Lightroom. They just make it quicker for you to get to a certain look. But LUTs through creative profiles in Lightroom, they let you do stuff that you cannot do in Lightroom directly with the presets. And that's the beauty about them.
Okay. Marcia says maybe offer some of Pete's books as a prize. if the, no,
okay,
no, that's
well,
all right.
The first
no,
one,
no, no,
the
no.
first one who I have a yeah, I have yeah.
I'm not going to force you to do that. That's not fair. I said
no, no
I'm
it's
not,
fine.
No. Let's
so
go on.
The first one who gets a question that I don't know the answer to okay.
Anyway, okay, so here's we're getting quite a lot of questions here. It's really good. Let's see here. Maureen Murphy says, "What's the eyedropper that appears when I use the spray paint tool?" I don't know of a spray
The
paint tool. The
eyedropper
only
that
spray paint
appears,
tool in Lightroom is the one
if you mean
for.
the painter tool.
Well, the spray paint, the one that has a spray paint is actually for is for like doing keywords
It's
and
for
other
painting all
things.
kinds of metadata, yeah.
Yeah, metadata. Right, right,
Yeah,
right.
I mean the painter tool can it's in the toolbar at the bottom and it can be used for all kinds of things. I for example, I use it to put images in the target collection. So I will create a collection, I will turn it into a target collection, and then it's very easy if like I have a number of images that I want to put in that collection, I just spray over it with the painter tool and they wind up in that collection. But you can use it to assign star ratings or whatever. But I mean, I don't get an
Yeah, I'm not sure I
eyedropper
understand the
icon
question.
on there.
Yeah.
Yeah, me neither.
Yeah.
So there's a difference. If we just don't understand the question, then you haven't stumped us. It's
No,
like we
that's
do have to
yeah.
understand the question
And it's
first.
not us. I'm not an expert here. So, but I mean, obviously I use Lightroom, so I know a lot of this stuff, but not like you. I mean, you've wrote the book. All right. So, we got a couple more here. And oh, by the way, so we're also going to later on in the program, we're actually going to unbox a Fuji. Yep, right there. The X-T4. And literally, this has not been opened. He has not opened it. So, and I know
I
that for a
have
fact
resisted
because he
temptation, yeah.
started opening it by accident a minute ago. He went, whoa, 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 whoa. And then went, oh, no, I can't do that. It's like, yep, thank you. Appreciate that honesty. So, anyway, so we've got, let's see, Jean Dubas says, Pete, what do you think of the X100V as a professional tool?
Well, I mean, that's probably a question more for you because I haven't used mine yet. I have ordered one, but it's not. I haven't gotten it yet because there was something wrong with it, so I need to send it back. So I haven't used it. But you've used it, and I mean, you made some really fantastic images in Calcutta with it.
Yeah, I mean, I love the camera. I've ordered it myself. The only reason I don't have it is because COVID broke and they literally couldn't get it to me because there was no one there to place the order. No, I think, Jean, I think that it can very, very easily be a professional tool. I think you've got the enough megapixels in there. You have it handles light amazing. It's got great dynamic range, and I was actually really shocked at the amount of dynamic range in a small image like that. And one of the things that I've have played with it in Lightroom is being able to take an underexpose. I like to do this ever since we've been doing them with the GFX images, where you take an underexposed image and you just pull it up and you bring in the exposure to it, and it's always amazing how far you can go with some of these Fuji files. And it does good. Now, here's a question we get a lot. Okay, Pete, this is one a lot. Roger Walton says, why does Lightroom not handle Fuji files well? I'm referring to the appearance of worms. There's that question about worms.
Yeah, the worms again. I don't know honestly, and I personally don't have the problem with it that a lot of other people seem to have. So I'm thinking maybe it's depends more on the kind of content that you shoot. That like I hear that especially from people who shoot a lot of greenery and stuff like trees and all, and so mostly landscape photographers, and this is completely the opposite of what I shoot. I also think it happens more if you shoot with fairly smaller apertures, like you and I tend to shoot fairly wide open. So I have, for me, it's never been an issue. Now, another thing is that recently, you and I have been shooting with the GFX a lot more, and that camera, insofar that the X-Trans sensor would have that problem, the GFX definitely doesn't have it because it's a Bayer pattern on that camera, and so it doesn't have the problem at all. But this it's not a cop out, but honestly, I don't experience the problem. I don't like I even hardly change the default sharpening settings on my images, any images. All my images, just most of the time they get the standard 40 sharpening in Lightroom, which is the default value of the sharpening slider, because that's already being tweaked under the hood by Lightroom. And for your specific brand of camera, I mean, and like I've read some advice on the internet back in the day, like what you should are supposed to do when you get these worms, and it's like put the detail slider to 100. And whenever I try that, and my images really start to look horrible, so I just don't.
Yeah, I have seen it. Maybe I mean I when you do have like an underexposed image, or where, in other words, when you overprocess something, when you push the boundaries and the limits of that file itself, I just see that as artifacts rather than a problem with a Fuji file itself. But you hear people talk about it all the time. I mean, let's be honest, there must be something there, because people are always talking about it. It's probably one of the most common complaints when it comes to Adobe Lightroom and the Fuji files. So, yeah. So let's we're going to come back to more questions in a minute, because I don't want to just do questions on Lightroom tonight, although we can do that. And in fact, I was thinking maybe if we had time, we could have you maybe show us some basic processing or how mm-hmm. to do something
sure.
in Lightroom, or maybe if someone has a question that we can take it into Lightroom to show it. I think that would be really cool too. But before we go there, I wanted to just kind of talk through, during this whole COVID-19 thing, you know, we're all staying at home. We're not out shooting much in these days. So I know that you're actually doing a lot of homeschooling stuff in the morning with your son. And, but beyond that, in the afternoons and the evenings, you've been doing a lot of, online workshops and things as well. Right. So can you tell us about what you've been up to?
Yeah. So the thing is, it was an idea I was toying with before COVID broke out, because I do a lot of live workshops and I do some online stuff as well. But it's been mostly up to now, like I will record a tutorial, and then I will edit it and I will put it up for sale. Like I have Lightroom tutorials and Photoshop tutorials like that. Mm-hmm. But the thing with these recorded tutorials as that I kind of miss the live aspect of it, because you're alone recording them, you're alone editing them, and then you're alone selling them basically. Mm-hmm. And so the fun thing is that because I had a couple of live workshops canceled because of the whole COVID thing, I thought, well, what if I was, you know, were to do a couple of webinars instead, and so live trainings, and that's what I started doing. And I did a couple of free ones, which I think still had really good content, because I hate the kind of webinar. And I think we've all followed those where, you know, you sign up for the webinar. It's a 1 hour webinar. You get 5 minutes of interesting content. And then there's a 55 minute sales pitch to buy a $2,000 course that's been discounted for 97%, or I don't know what. So I hate those kind of webinars, so I don't want to give them myself. But then I also started experimenting, but I was also thinking, I need to make a living, and I cannot just do that by giving free webinars, as good as they are. And so I've done a Luminar course online as a three-part webinar. I've done I'm starting a Dutch Lightroom course, and I also have, which might be interesting for the people watching, I have a two-part live talk with Damien Lovegrove, who we talked about at the introduction, who I learned my off-camera lighting from, in a big part at least, next week. So if people want to know more about that, that's on morethanwords.be/deconstructed, because he's going to deconstruct some of his best images there. I'll type it in the feed later on. But so yeah, I've been doing a lot of those, and it's fun because it's a lot more interactive than just recording a tutorial. It's a bit like this basically. It's just live. You get the adrenaline of being live, and you can still record it. And people who sign up for the live shows also get a recording afterwards. So it's kind of the best of both worlds, and I really enjoy it.
And then you're and so the thing with Damien, what is it exactly? I'm not following.
It's basically Damien's going to do a live talk. I'm entering the URL right now in the chat here on Facebook. It's a two-part live talk in which he's going to basically deconstruct, like in each session he's going to deconstruct about 40 of his favorite images. The first one is going to be 40 black and white images. That's next week on Tuesday the 19th, and then the second one is on the 21st, and then he's going to talk about 30-40 of his color images. And so he's going to talk about, you know, the lighting he used, the ideas behind the shot, how he got the model to look a particular way. So it's very inspirational. We're not going to talk f-stops, or, well, maybe a little, but I mean, we're not going to talk about cameras or megapixels. It's just a very inspirational talk, and lots of really great examples on what you can do to improve your portrait photography. And I'm really excited. So I'm hosting it, and Damien's going to tune in live from Bristol. And he's working on his images. Well, now he's actually he might be joining us. So Damien, yeah,
he
go
was
back
here
to
a while ago.
Your images.
I saw, I saw him pop in. So yeah. If you're out there, Damien,
yeah,
say
okay.
Hi. So, but
so okay. Anyway, so that's next week, and yeah.
All right. So, now you don't. What you things you don't do is you don't do like a lot of people do like tech manuals on gear and things like that. You don't really do that, do you?
No. I think it's no. Like, first of all, imagine doing a book on the, like, there's a guy, Rico Pfirstinger, you know him, I know him. Mm-hmm. He makes great books on the X-T4 and whatnot, but it's just, it's too tech. I mean, I'm known as a geek, but that's, even for me, it's too geeky. I'm working, as you said, I'm working on a book with 101 tips on travel photography, and we're uh-huh. both working on a video course about travel photography. Now, I was actually about to launch the book now, but with the whole COVID thing, I'm going to postpone the launch, obviously, because nobody can travel anyway. But that's what I do like to do, like some tips with a mix of some practical tips and then some more philosophical tips, but that appealed to a broader range of cameras. But really the nitty-gritty tips, it's just not for me. It's too specific.
I would think it'd be just downright hard to do. I mean, because for one thing, there's all these little nuances and all these little teeny things involved.
Exactly.
With a, you know, especially, I mean, now you and I both, obviously, you know, we're both Fuji ambassadors. But one of the things that is sort of if there's one area of Fuji that frustrates me, it's like their menu system. It goes forever, you know? And, And so can you imagine having – I don't know how Rico does it, where he writes this and he goes through all the different menu items and what they do and everything like that. It's just – it would be crazy. So, But
And then, you know, by the time you've written the book, the X-T5 comes along and you can start again. And the thing is, you know, when I have a problem, I just call my friend René. And I think he's watching too.
He
So
is, yeah.
he's René Delbar. He's the official ex-geek of Fujifilm Belgium. He even is on their trade shows in the booth. And people can just, you know, can just stump him with any question that they have about
they can't stump him, they can try, that they can't,
well, they can't, yeah, they can try to stump him, really, yeah. And I also, I don't know about you, but the more advanced the cameras get, I'm starting to sound like an old fart right now probably, but and I am getting that too, but you know, the more features that get added, the less I use. I have my own, like in my Fuji cameras, I have my set of features that I use, and all the new stuff that gets added. Like I was actually kind of mad at Fujifilm because in the they added one feature to kind of sway DSLR users their way, and it's the feature where you can set the viewfinder up to
I hate that.
To show the to see you, so when you're shooting you see through the viewfinder, but then when you've made the shot it appears on the LCD, and I just hate that feature. Because I always think my camera's broken, but because I look at my image through the viewfinder, also the one I just shot, because that's the best way of viewing at it, mm-hmm. Of looking at it. So I want a new firmware update that lets me disable that specific part of the firmware update. I'm just a creature of habit, like most of us.
Well, you know, and it's interesting you say that, because I think that's the way I am with Lightroom. And I know you're not that way with Lightroom. Like every time Lightroom comes out, you're like, oh, great. Did you know we can now do this and we can do that? But I'm like, no, I don't need all that. I don't use the presets. I don't use any of that stuff. I use the develop module and the basic pane, and then a few of the other panes, mm-hmm. and that's it. And then of course I use the brushes and I don't even know what you call them all, but anyway, but that's it. I mean, and like you. I've listened to you teach on Lightroom and talk about all the different, what's all this new stuff they did the last two or three
the range
versions
masks.
Back. What is it?
The range
no,
masks,
no.
You mean, but those.
No, that's good too. No, I'm talking about how they gave profiles or something, and they made a whole new deal where you can create your own profiles.
Creative
and,
profiles.
Oh, well, is that what
you
said?
You can
I'm sorry.
Use the LUTs in. Yeah. So,
oh, sorry.
So those
I
are.
Hear.
I mean, there's for anybody listening who's still on Lightroom 6, for example, I know a lot of people complain about the $10 a month for the Lightroom and Photoshop plan, but actually, it's a steal, folks. For $10 a month, the Lightroom and Photoshop, you know. You and I know this. The streaming software we use costs twice as much than that. And I mean, it's very good software, but you know, I use that a lot less than I use my Lightroom and my Photoshop.
Right.
So it's all relative. And so there's so many new features in Lightroom. And I mean, some of them are like small things that you know you can do without, but. Like the range masks in Lightroom, which I showed in the little demo I did when we were at Calcutta, that those are just phenomenal. They save you so much editing time. And then the creative profiles. And even if you don't want to make creative profiles yourself, there's other people making creative profiles, such as me, for example. And you can get those and It's you know, we should do another one of these and just talk about maybe my top five new features in Lightroom Classic, you know.
Okay, we can do that. But hey, but let me go back to one thing. I have a Lightroom question for you. Okay, so here's my Lightroom question for you. I'm gonna stump you with this. So my Lightroom question is, why is it that even now after I think I'm right. Since the X-T3, we've had at least I'm trying to think of the Fuji film simulation that was came out with the X-T3. It was the what's it called? Help me here.
Eterna.
No, not Eterna. No? That came out before that. This is the sort of the latest one. Where's
Renee
when you
need him?
Bleach
bypass?
No, yeah, that is actually the latest one, but that's not the one I'm thinking of either. But anyway, it doesn't matter. Well, it does matter, but I can't think of it. But the point being is that it isn't showing up in Lightroom under the Fuji presets. Why is that? In other words, under the camera, the camera
matching profiles,
yeah.
Well, it should. But the thing is that normally, you know, not all Fuji cameras have all simulations available to them. So, like for example, if you would open up an X-Pro1 RAW file in Lightroom, you'll see that the list of available film simulations is a lot shorter than if you open an X-T4.
It's classic
and
neg.
So classic neg, yeah, that's well, if it's not available in camera as an option, then normally it's not available in Lightroom as a camera matching profile.
Yeah, but that's not the case.
So that's
it
the
is
logic.
Because it is available in the X-T3. And then it was available, not the X-T3. It was available in the. It was available. Okay, it was. It came out. It came out with the X-Pro3. That's when that one came out. It was came out with the X-Pro3, and it wasn't available in Lightroom then. Maybe because X-Pro3 was still too new. Because now
yeah.
I don't have
so
the X-Pro3.
Normally, what happened? Yeah.
But then it
is
came
at
out.
First they.
But it's also in the X100V, and I don't think it's there. Yeah.
I think it could be that, for example, you know, generally they first add support for the camera, and that sometimes that support is preliminary, like they will support the RAW files. But they, especially when there's new simulations out, they may not have found the time to create the proper camera matching profile yet. Because I don't know if you've looked at them, but the ones that exist do a pretty cool job of actually, you know, simulating the in-camera profile. Like I've done tests, I've shot 7 different profiles on my camera on the JPEG, and then I applied the same profiles on the RAWs, and I cannot tell them apart. So the camera matching profiles are really very, very good, but I suppose it takes some time to make them. And maybe what happened is that they didn't get around to creating that profile yet. Are you on the latest update already, 9.2? Because that's the latest one. So I would definitely try updating to the latest version, and it could also be that somebody just downright forgot to add it. But
no,
we're
having several people. Several people have said that it's available, and so I think what's happened for me is when I've both of the two cameras I had, it wasn't there for the X100V and it wasn't there for the X-Pro3 when I did them. And I think that's probably because now will it be there it'll be there if you don't shoot it in that, right? I mean, in other words, you can just shoot it in another profile.
That's the beauty about
exactly.
That's the beauty about the system. And also, for example, one of the things, and that's why I think we really should do another one of these specific for Lightroom, is that I just did a webinar in Dutch this week on Monday, where I showed people like the new camera default system in Lightroom 9.2, so the classic 9.2. You can actually have Lightroom automatically, by default, apply the film simulation that you shot on your camera on the raw file. So instead of having to manually select it from a list and hopefully remembering which one you used in the first place, Lightroom does it for you. And by the way, that doesn't only apply to Fujifilm cameras, it applies to any camera. So if you're listening and you're shooting a Nikon, for example, Z7, and you like the vivid, in Nikon terms, it's called the picture control, right? So what Fujifilm calls film simulations, Nikon calls picture control. So if you like your vivid picture control, well, then you can set up Lightroom in a way that automatically, if you shoot vivid, the raw you import will have the vivid camera matching profile applied to it. Mm-hmm. So that's a really big time saver.
We were talking about how Rene is the man to go to with all this stuff, right? So, of course, he has the answer. He says, Fujifilm's policy with Lightroom is to only offer the camera matching profiles for the film simulations available natively on the specific camera model. So that sounds like, if I'm reading what Rene is saying, then if I have a X-Pro3 image, I can't put classic NEG simulation on an X-Pro3 image.
If it's not available by default, you cannot add classic NEG, for example, to an X-Pro1 image.
Right, that's what I'm saying. When it's not available on the X-T3, yeah. Well, maybe it is with an upgrade, but it wasn't when the X-T3 mm-hmm. came out. So.
And you could actually try changing, but I don't know if that would work. That you could try hacking the EXIF info of the RAW file, and maybe you could try, if you turned your X-T3 into an X-Pro3 RAW file, so to speak, if it would show up then, I'm not sure. But if your computer explodes doing that, don't blame me. Some people, I think that basically also that's really overdoing it.
Okay, so we've been talking. Yeah, it's all right. So we've been talking about this stuff now for a good 45 minutes now. I think it's time that we did an unboxing.
Yeah. Let me pull up some light here because it's starting to get dark here.
Okay.
Then switch on my camera.
Turn on your other camera.
I'm going to scoot this over.
Rene says, so, yes, Matt, you're right, yeah, but there are workarounds. Talking about the film simulation. All right. So while you're doing this, while you get set up, I'm going to do a commercial. So right now, I would like you to consider signing up for my email. And when you do, you get this book called 25 Tips, Tricks, and Gear Suggestions for the Traveling Photographer. It is available upon download after you sign up for my mailing list. Of course, the mailing list will let you know about all the new and upcoming interviews that we're doing with photographers. We've got several coming up. I'm going to be doing a whole workshop very soon. In Friday, I'm doing a composition workshop as well as talking about lenses, and that's going to be done this Friday. But you'll know all the timing and everything if you sign up. Not only do you get all kinds of information about gear and all kinds of things that make travel easier, you also get a bonus packing list in the at the end of the ebook. Pete, are you all set up? Oh, there it is. Look at there.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
So here we are. And in the background, you see the cable mess that is an unfortunate result of doing live streams.
We need a drum roll. So, but I don't
You
have a
have
sound
sound effects
effect.
in there, don't
I
you?
know, but I don't have. I have an air horn. I got a bicycle horn. I have applause. I can do applause.
But do
Okay,
applause, you
I
know,
did.
do some preemptive applause.
I did. I just did
Okay.
applause. All right. So let's go
All
for it.
right, good. So, yeah. So,
So.
honestly, folks, this is, I mean, this has been in my office for like a week. And you, by the way, the way you can know that this is live and I haven't cheated is that if you've ever opened a box of these, you know there is no way to put everything back inside looking like it's never been opened. It's just impossible. I mean, so what do we have here? We have manuals. That's the first thing I throw away because I have Renee for that. Warranty cards.
Now, this one has
Oh,
a
there it
different.
is.
Oh, you got
So I got the
the
silver one,
graphite silver. Now, is this the same as graphite or is it
nostalgic.
different?
I don't even know. What does it say on the box? It says silver.
Okay,
Is there
so it's.
another one? I don't even know. I
I
think they
don't
had there are only
know.
two
Lately, they've
versions,
been
right? It's
doing.
the X-Pro 3 that has
Three colors, yeah.
yeah.
Just rip it.
Oh, how cool. I don't know if that's mine, but they have these already on there. You
Oh
see the little.
yeah.
That
And
normally takes
oh,
me
and it's a
half a day
different.
to get these on, so.
I know it's a different strap connector too. It's got a plastic sleeve on it.
Yeah, that too. Yeah, wow. See, all interesting stuff. So, great. Then
Was that
there's
a
the
so it's.
accessories.
It's not a kit, so there's no lens, right? It's just the body only.
It's just the body. Yeah. I have plenty of lenses.
Now, do you have a
I actually got the.
X-T3 sitting there, or are you shooting it with the?
I'm filming myself. The image you see in front of me is the X-T3.
Okay.
Yeah. So, USB-C cable. Aha, and this is the subject of a lot of talk. The
Yeah.
well, I have to put it. The new battery.
The Canon battery. I've heard
Yeah,
people
well,
say it looks like a
yeah. Is
Canon
it? I
battery.
mean,
No, but
yeah.
I've heard people say
Oh,
it
and you
looks
see
like
that the
one.
lid is a lot bigger too. Yeah. So this is. Oh, I'll have to put it in the right way. Okay, like this.
Well, unlike the other Fuji batteries, I don't think you can put that one in the wrong way.
Yeah. No, yeah. I think let me try. Let's see how idiot-proof this is. Well, you can put it in, but it won't lock. So
Okay.
that's already an advantage. So yeah. New battery, and then obviously the second big
Oh.
change, which is the I like this because you know there's a lot of debate about the flip screen because it's tiltable, right? But that means you can so not every I mean like street shooters are not super excited about this, but on the other
Yeah.
hand, filmmakers will be because you can basically turn it all the way around.
Yeah, they made a
And
selfie
obviously,
screen
what I
out of
also
it.
like is, yeah, but what you can also do is, do the X-Pro 3 thing and just have it closed.
Well, honestly,
Yeah, and that way
that's
I don't
the.
have to.
Go ahead.
No, and that way I hope there's. What would be cool if is the if the firmware now detected that it was closed, and so. If I take an image that it always just displays in the viewfinder, I would really love that. And it doesn't show up on the LCD closed because, so
Now, it
yeah, and
when
other than
it,
that, it's looking nice.
yeah. So, how's that color compared to like graphite and stuff?
I don't know. It's a bit if I put it next to my, well, it's a bit the graphite one is darker, I think.
Yeah.
This
Okay.
is
This
fairly
is gonna be the same color that
silvery.
the X100V is, I think.
Probably, yeah. From what I know, you had a black one in,
I had a black one, yeah.
didn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, it's got the big GFX strap too.
But it's a bigger camera, right?
So, it's slightly bigger. Yeah, it's slightly bigger, but not that much. I've seen comparisons. And for example, it's smaller than the XH1, which is funny. It's a bit bigger than the X-T3, but it's smaller than the XH.
Now, all the...
I'm actually looking for a flash, but I don't see the flash in there. Not that I could care less, but...
Yeah, I was going to say, that's just what you need. What is that? Is that the charger?
That's the charger. Yeah, so it's USB-C charge, apparently. So this is the charger. Yeah.
That's strange looking.
Oh, and that's what the cable is for. And maybe Renee knows all
so
about
this. Wait, so you have to charge the battery in the camera?
Yeah, I think so.
That doesn't make sense.
You can get a charger for it, but... you can get a charger for it, but it's not included as far as I know.
Does the door come off?
Dual card slot? No, I don't know.
Not that one. Not that door. The other door. Yeah, that one. For videography. The X-T3, you can take the door off.
It's a different
style door.
Renee knows. Renee will put it in the chat. So here's the USB-C. Yeah, I think I'll probably get a.
Renee says there's no flash
like a
anymore.
Dual battery charger. There isn't. Well,
no, you can get it as an accessory.
I don't care. I mean, okay, I don't care. I have like three of those X-T3 and 2 flashes, the small ones, lying around somewhere over here. So anyway, that's the unboxing of the. X-T4.
Yeah, that is the screen that they said they should have put on the X-Pro 3. I think that's where they missed it on the X-Pro 3. They should have had that screen on it. I don't know if I like that screen, honestly, because I tend to use it flip down a lot. You know, like in a waist level finder. I can just see that thing being snapped right off. Now you can flip it around and turn it back, though, right?
Yeah, so, you can do it. You can do this, right?
So, yeah.
But then you cannot tilt it like that anymore.
Yeah,
but what you can do though is if you want to, for example, shoot vertical.
Yeah, that's
so
nice.
So I mean, every drawback has its own advantages, I think. So so this you can do, or you can even shoot like this, for example, if you want to shoot from above vertically.
Oh, that's kind of cool,
you could
too.
Angle the camera down. So, I mean,
that's give and take.
The fact that you cannot tilt it like this anymore when it's locked here, that's a downside compared to how it was, but it opens up other opportunities. So, you know.
So, Renee says that the door on the right does come off for videographers. Oh. Being able to change out cards and stuff. No, the door on the right.
Okay.
Cool. Oddly enough, the door on the left, which used to be a single door on the X-T3, doesn't come off. So, interesting. All right. Well, thank you very much. You're in control of your screen there, so you can put it back.
Yeah. I'll switch back to
all right.
This here. Yeah.
Okay. So I want to look at some of your photos, and I think it's only fair. We've been talking like you're some hotshot photographer, and yet people can't even see your pictures. They don't even know what you do.
Yeah,
so there's several
We've
of them
chased
here.
Half of them away with the gear talk probably already. So.
Yeah, probably. Well, I don't know. It might people love gear. So, all right. So
yeah,
let's look at this. So, here's. Here is the very first one we're going to do. This I love this shot. She is so stunningly beautiful, and the light on that is just beautiful. So obviously you're using off-camera light on this, and
the funny thing is that this is every once in a while Damien Lovegrove pops over to Belgium. I mean, it's only the channel in between the two countries. Mm-hmm. And so this was on a freestyle shoot where we had this really lovely model, Rosalind. She's Dutch, and she has just this very aristocratic face, and this is in Austin by the by the beach, it's lit with, it's an X100V, or X1, not the V obviously, but it's like an X100 shot. And I was trying to make a point that I could do something even with a cable, you know, without triggers. And so this is, I think, the Nissan i40, so like a really low power flash connected to a cable, a 10 meter TTL cable running back to the X100 that I was using. And
was there
the
a modifier?
Nice thing about the X100 that, you know, there's a small softbox in there as well, yeah. But the nice thing about the X100 is that, without getting too much into tech stuff, but as you know, it can sync up to a very high shutter speed, like 1/1000 or 2/1000 of a second, which means that you don't need to use a very powerful flash to get the effect of a powerful flash. And that's what I did here, because this is shot in broad daylight. With a small flash, but because of the X100, the way it works, it looks like I use a big light or anything, but it's just a small flash. And I love that shot too.
It's really everything great about that shot. I love it. So now this is different.
Yeah. That's
what's the story on this?
This is just a buddy of mine, and he's a steampunker, and so steampunkers are like, steampunk is this mix of Victorian attire mixed up with some science fiction elements
and
a lot of clocks and bells and details. And so I started photographing steampunkers because, you know, I had to do a couple of demos on the GFX50 and then later the GFX100. And so one of the advantages of these cameras, as you know, is that they resolve a lot of fine detail. And so I was looking for subjects with lots of fine detail. And I mean, you can do more fine detail in a person shoot than a steampunker. And so I just really love, but I also love the time they put into their costumes. This, like this guy, he's we call him the Major. He's Major Theodoricus. He's got his own website and everything. He's like a professional steampunk model. And I just like the fact that there's people doing that. And he's in lockdown. He spent a lot of days working on a new hat, for example, for his outfit. And this is shot in an old abandoned factory, which is something I also like urbex shooting, urban exploration. But contrary to most folks, I like to put people in those old factories. And so this is one of those shoots in an old paper factory. And I like the steel, and then it just goes together really well,
I think.
Yeah,
it does. I think we're going to have another one here. Okay. Is this the same guy?
Yeah, this is the same guy in the same building, but this is a wider shot. And so most of this is all done in camera. The only thing obviously I didn't do in camera was the
flame.
The flame coming out from the, but like the gun, he assembled it. This is obviously a completely not working gun. It's taped together from all kinds of stuff. But I just love these subjects because they're, I mean, if you put some dramatic light on a subject like that and you add some smoke like I did here, I mean, it just gives really fun images.
These are shot with one light or two? How many lights on this?
There's three lights in here. There's a key light coming in from the right on him. Then there's a kicker light coming from the left, so like on his the bottom part of his coat, his overcoat, you can see that little white line. So that's the second light, and then there's the third light behind him, aimed at that pillar, because I like the structure and the rivets on the pillar, but they were completely dark, and so I added a third light there. to bring out the texture in that pillar a little bit more. Yeah.
Now, I was talking with somebody the other day. It was Bobby, she does a lot of flash, obviously, but she uses a light meter every time, all the time, a strobe meter, a cyconic. You don't use a light meter at all. Why? Well, I mean, tell me the what you think is an advantage for not spending a little money and buying a light meter.
Well, because for the money of the light meter, I can buy another flash. Yeah, no, it's true. I mean, the Siconic, they're good light meters, don't get me wrong. But I think with digital, I mean, and I know the professional thing to say and do is to use a light meter, but I like, I build my lights one at a time. So I'll start with the ambient exposure first. So I'll leave all the lights off. So for example, the like in the skylight you see in this image, this is all lit by the available light coming in through that skylight. So my first priority in here is I want that skylight not to be completely blown out. So I will set my exposure, my just the camera's exposure without any flash, so that looks the way it wants, the way I want it to rather. And that, for example, will turn that steel pillar way too dark. But that's not a problem because I can change that with flash. And then I start to build up my set one flash at a time. So generally, I first do the key light, get it to look the way I want it, and I just adjust the power and I look on my LCD screen. And then I add the second light, in this case, the rim light for the back of his coat. And then I added a third light. And I find that working methodically like that, I just don't need a light meter. But I get it that people, because I most of what I do is also environmental portraiture. So I like this is an environment where, I have to work quickly. I don't have all day. And I just think that the instant feedback of the LCD just works for me. I mean, a lot of people using light meters are generally people who come from a studio environment, and I get it that in studio environments where you want the exact precise amount of light, that their light meter is critical. But like when I want my shot to be in the ballpark of what I want, and then I know that I can still tweak stuff a little bit later on.
Let me ask you a question on this, because I hear people talk, because I'm on the Godox forum with you. We both use Godox
Yeah,
flash,
sure.
but I hear people always talking about how, and I wish Damien was here, he could answer some of these as well. But I hear people always talking about the color balance of the light and this light over that light, and if you use it even so often that it shifts depending on the speed of the light or whatever, and so I think about that and I hear that and I think, well, if I was photographing like a book or a piece of cloth or a
Or a
watch
painting,
band or a painting that I needed to duplicate the exact colors, I could see where that would be very, very important. But for stuff like this, or stuff like you're shooting in Kolkata or something, to me that just seems like it just doesn't need to be. I mean, it's just I don't know. I don't get it because I'm especially now. I tend to do a lot less work in Lightroom than you do. However, I think yours is to the point. In other words, you're taking this image and you're adjusting everything in this image. I mean, you've got your highlights pulled down. You've got your shadows pulled up. You've got your colors are less vivid, so you've pulled down your saturation probably a little bit on this, and so on and so forth. So does it even matter what the lights were originally?
No, exactly. That's the point. So I can like I mean, and Godox has a line. They have their Pro line of flashes, which is a lot more color, which has a color consistency mode. Now, I've like 90% of my work, the actual color isn't that important because I change the hell out of it anyway, as you mentioned. So it doesn't really matter to me. But if it does matter to you, if you're shooting fashion or any of the other things you refer to, okay. But then you can get the Pro line of Godox flashes, and those are a lot more color consistent. Or you can buy, you know, you can spend $5,000 on a Bron color flash, which will probably be more color consistent too. But I prefer to get the Godox and buy me a GFX with the spare money than, you know.
So it really is a practicality thing for you as well.
Sure. And like, you know, for example, my 8600s, you've been with me. I've dragged these. These are like $500. Sometimes you can get them, especially in the States, on sale, like for $400, $500. These are 600 watt flashes, which, you know, I have never had a problem with their color accuracy. But even if they're not the most color accurate flashes, for $500, you get a lot of power for your money. And like mine have never let me down. I've traveled across the world with them, and they still work after 3 years of shooting like crazy. Yeah.
Let's put it in perspective. How much does a I don't even know what the Canon flash is these days, but the Nikon or the Canon top of the line speed light.
Hot shoe. Yes, $500-$600.
Exactly. It's basically the same price or even more than what you get a 600 watt studio flash battery power that you can. That's the thing that blows me away. You know.
Yeah.
Okay.
For example, I have the Pro. I have the 8600 Pro by Godox, which is the more color consistent one of the two. Mm-hmm. And yet, my favorite one is the old 600 because the Pro, it's a bit bigger, it's a bit heavier, but the main reason is the Pro's battery only lasts for 350 shots, which is still an important feat, you know. It's 350 shots is a lot, but the 600, the original 600s, last for 500 shots. And like, you know, on the workshops we are, people tend to work our flashes pretty hard. So I'll take 30% more flash, capacity over 10% better color stability any time of the day.
Okay. So here we have a ballerina, and I think you've shot this young lady quite a bit as well.
Yeah. She's my favorite ballerina model. She's also a great person. That's why she's super positive and everything. And this is an abandoned cooling tower somewhere in Belgium. And just maybe the fun thing here is
are these legal to go into and shoot?
Well, I didn't know. I didn't break open any door. So I mean.
Okay.
You can walk in there. I'm not saying you should, but you can. Sometimes you can. I mean, when it's closed, I don't go in there. But a lot of these things are, you know, it's a big scene, the urbex scene. And
Do you ever have to run people out?
For example,
You ever have to run homeless people out or anything like that?
No, not in this particular location. I mean, but the nice thing is it just the first time I went in there, it feels like you're inside of a science fiction set. It's super impressive. And so this was actually used as a location in a Belgian movie. As well. And so that's why that, you know, it used to be the thing she's standing on wasn't always there, because this is actually a pit where the condensed steam of the cooling tower goes into. But they put this metal grid on there
to protect
because they needed it for the movie. Yeah. And also possibly to protect the film, because I haven't seen the movie personally.
What movie
is it? So this now makes for a It's called the Prime Minister. It's a Dutch. It's a Belgian movie, so it's Dutch. Okay. It's Belgian spoken. I don't think it got translated. I have to watch it though. And so you, now basically, you know, you can have people standing there. What you don't see in this shot though is that there's actually, this is something I often do, like there's somebody holding a light over her and there's two rim lights on either side of her actually in the frame, because this is such a wide shot that if I had to put my lights outside of the frame, they would just be not powerful enough. And also they would light everything, and I only wanted them to light her. So what I did is I take two shots on a tripod. I just shoot the whole thing with all the gear in place. And then I ask her to step away. I ask my assistant to step away. We take away the two rim lights, and we take another shot of just the empty background. And because that shot with the same settings, only without flash, it's very easy to composite both of them, you know, together. I just use the empty plate to take out all the lights that and all the junk that is in the lit shot.
Okay.
And it gives for a nice surreal effect.
Yeah. Yeah, we do this effect all the time. Not Urbex, but we do the whole take the light, move it, take the picture, put the light back in, take it all the time. So here's another one of your buddy.
Yeah, that's the same guy, actually. So this is for a tutorial I've recorded, and it's still in the editing phase, but this is going to be a really cool tutorial about location lighting. And so this is, again, in one of those abandoned factories, especially the south of the country has loads of them. And so... what I like about this one, because you really should see the buildup. So basically, there's three lights in here. He's not lit from the front, and that's done on purpose to keep it mysterious. So there's two strip lights behind each of the two pillars on the left and the right. And then what I think really finishes this image or gives it the finishing touch is that there's a little speed light, and that's what I like about the Godox system. You can mix and match big powerful strobes with small speed lights with a blue gel behind him, and it's pointed straight upwards, and that's something you rarely do to light something from the bottom, because it tends to make that person look very ominous. But if you do it on a structure like here, it actually makes that structure look ominous, which is what I wanted in this. So I wanted to give like some kind of mothership landing or something. And then there's my eternal smoke machine, which I also love. That's the Scotty from Smoke Factory, which is one of the very few portable and battery-powered smoke machines that exist. And I have it with... I would love to take it on our travel photography workshops. It cannot go onto a plane, unfortunately, but otherwise...
Why not?
What we would have
it?
So much fun.
Yeah.
It's the battery. It's like a lead or I don't know. It's not the typical lithium batteries, because these things are, I'm not a tech guy, but these things need a very powerful battery that can draw a lot of power at once. And because of that, the way the battery works, you cannot take it on a plane.
Okay. All right, so now we've got your ballerina girl again, the same girl?
Yeah, same girl. This is, the funny thing is, this is her mother's favorite shot of her, so I was very pleased with that, because ultimately, I mean, a lot of these photographs I take just for my personal enjoyment and because there's some teaching involved probably, and obviously the model generally likes the shots, but other than that, I don't publish them other than on my website. But then to hear that this is her mother's favorite shot, that just, you know, makes the whole experience more worth it. And this is again one that where I did just the same technique. In the original image, there's a lot of flashes in the frame, but I just took them out afterwards using a second shot of the exact same thing, but without the flashes and the model in it.
I love you used a cable spool. That's what she's sitting on
yeah,
the chair
yeah, yeah,
on the
exactly,
cable
exactly.
spool.
And that was just, we probably moved it a little bit, but that's the thing that was there. And I liked like the two leading lines of the skylights leading mm-hmm. straight at her. And so this is also one of the things that in this case, compared, for example, to the other image in the cooling tower, there you could see that the light was artificial. And I don't care that much because, you know, it's just, it's she's lit for effect. But what I like in this one here is that, you know, the lighting here is actually really believable because mm-hmm. although it's flash, the light coming in from the left skylight could be lighting her in theory. And the light coming in from the right skylight could be the backlight. But in reality, when you would just rely on those lights, it would, you know, she would be completely underexposed.
Like the
but
background.
But I put the flashes in the, yeah, exactly. I put the flashes in the general direction of the existing light. And so it kind of fools the viewer into thinking, well, you know, a photographer will know that this is flash, but her mother doesn't know that this is flash, and she doesn't care either, right. By the way. So, yeah.
Well, I think your mother probably likes it because it's very graceful. There's just this, I love the contrast in this, and I'm not talking about the color, but I'm talking about the, she's young, she's very feminine, she's soft, there's, you know, the lines on her are soft, her skin is soft, you know, there's all this softness about her, and then in juxtaposition to the rough, edgy, dark, everything yeah. else in the frame, and so there's that beautiful contrast there, and everything, she's graceful, you know, in the way she's sitting with her toes up like that, and even the ribbon on her shoe is mm-hmm. gracefully going, and then again it's that juxtaposition to all the harsh sharp lines of the place. So yeah, I think it works great. Yeah,
we've said that once this lockdown stuff is over, we'll go out for another shoot, because that's what I like about working with like artists, or like for example the steampunker, or in this case the ballerina, or other creative people. It's that they also put a lot of themselves into these images, and they're very great. They're great subjects because they also, and they like to go the extra mile to get the shot, where, you know, she had to be very patient. It was cold in there. I had to retouch a lot of goosebumps. but she just went on and on and on because she knew the result was going to be good. And I'm not sure that everybody else, like the traditional classical beauty models, would, you know, would have waited so long, because I work very slowly, as you know.
Yeah. That's an understatement. Okay, now this is not her. What is this?
Now this is another girl. She's a very I think she's 15 or something. She's a very good also dancer. She was in Belgium's Got Talent, but that was, you know, after this shoot. And this is the same location actually. It's just a different part of that old building. And again, this is using two lights, and this is something that I've done more ever since I hang out with Damien Lovegrove a lot more, and that is to use hard light or harder lights than I used to, and it's just a two light setup, and she's just jumping, and there's a little bit of, you know, smoke again. I really love smoke in this context, and it makes almost gives a feel like she's the building is above the clouds or something, whereas in reality it's just, you know, a meter above the ground. And I like the contrast of the red with the almost desaturated background.
Okay, so now we're gonna head off to Mongolia.
Yeah.
So tell us
for
about
some
this.
Reason it's hard to believe. I always see these images, and it to me it feels like a lot longer ago than it is, because this is 2 years ago now. And this is a trip that you and I did together.
I think all the images from now on are trips that you and I have done together.
Yeah, probably. And so, yeah, this is something we've both wanted to do for a long time. And we had a couple of friends joining, and a super well-organized trip by our buddy Greg. And this is just, yeah, this was, I think, one of my favorite trips. Getting to spend a couple of days with these eagle hunters.
Yeah, so this guy is the son of the main eagle hunter. I'm trying to remember his name off the top of my head. I was just writing it the other day. But it was interesting because he was sitting there while we were shooting his father, and he was sitting there, and then it was just such a natural pose that mm-hmm. I think this does have a flash on it, doesn't it?
Oh, sure.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure it did. But I know that because we shot him without flash as well, because we were using flash on his dad, the reason I was saying that. So,
No, what you actually have here is that there's... And I don't mind, because this is shot at 1/125th of a second, which is the sync speed of the GFX. And at that speed, there's a little bit of motion blur in the eagle's feathers. Mm-hmm. And I actually like it that way, because it gives a bit of movement to what would otherwise be a too static image, probably. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. But I like his expression. Mm-hmm. I like the short light on him. Which is something I almost always use. And then this one, the next one
also short
coming
lit
up here.
So for people that don't know, short lit means that the shadow side of the face is facing the camera, and which gives a much more dramatic, sort of moody feel to things.
Okay. That's the main reason why we use flash, because flash allows you to short light anything. You don't have to wait for the sun to be in a short light position to watch the subject. You can just do short light all day. So this one is, I remember this one was crazy to pull off. So this is shot in two separate shots, also with the camera on a tripod, because, you know, one with the light on the closest eagle hunter, and then one move the light closer to the second one. And I remember it was so windy up there that you can see it on the bird's eagle, on the eagle's wings as well. Mm-hmm. But it was so windy that I think we needed three people to prevent the softbox from blowing over. It was, I think it was a 110 or the 90, I don't remember, but so a 1 meter wide softbox. And there was actually three people holding on to it, or otherwise it would just blow away. And you know, the memory of those efforts is also fun, because you schlep all that gear up that hill, not knowing what you're gonna get, and then you have a small window to make the shot. And this is one of my favorite Mongolia shots.
So almost all of these shots are shot with the GFX now. So you have switched over from shooting the X-T series and are predominantly shooting the GFX. Is that strictly because of the size of it, or the detail of it, or the dynamic range of it, or all of the above?
All the above, and also it's just because I'm a bit of a geek, I guess, because honestly, like, I don't need a GFX. I mean, nobody is paying me to hang 2x3 meter prints on their walls or anything. So it's just that I like good equipment. And what I mostly like is I like to process images. I probably like processing and editing images more than I like shooting them, although the GFX has really increased my
shooting enjoyment, but and the files of the GFX are just you can throw anything at them. They just they're indestructible they outlive anything, and that's what I like. They give you so much creative freedom. And also I have been thinking, and I've talked to you about that, I have been thinking of putting up some of my images for sale, like fine art prints. And obviously for that, the bigger the file is, the bigger you can print. So that's a consideration too.
Yeah. But it's interesting you admit that about the fact that you enjoy processing maybe as much or more than you do actually taking the picture, because I'm the opposite. And I think, but it's interesting to watch you shoot though, because I would almost say I wouldn't believe it, because you spend so much time getting the shot set right and, you know, taking the image and then taking, you know, 20 or 30 images of it, you know, because you want it. So, you know, because you are a perfectionist and
and too much, babe, probably.
I'm just saying, I think that's what makes a good photographer is being a perfectionist. But if you spend that much time and that much effort to get the image, and then you say you enjoy it even more in Lightroom, so how much on an image like this or one of the other ones, how much time do you actually spend on that image in Lightroom?
It depends. Not that much, honestly. I mean, I think you would be surprised. Other than, for example, if I have to mask out softboxes, that takes some time in Photoshop. But my Lightroom workflow is actually pretty simple. I have my own presets and my creative profiles, and that's what I like about them. They let you basically bake very complex looks into just a single click. And then what I do is, where somebody else might spend 15 minutes getting all the sliders the way they want to get a specific look, I will apply one of my creative profiles. That's a one-click effect. I might, you know, change the amount slider a little bit if I think it's too much for that particular image. And then all that time that I gain compared to somebody else who has to put all the sliders there manually, I just invest in a little bit of local adjustments, some dodging and burning. And I think it's that final step, the little bit of local shadow recovery, highlight recovery, whatever, that, you know, makes the difference between a good looking image and a great looking one. But honestly, I think a lot of people would be surprised how little time I spend I know a lot of people who do all their color grading in Photoshop with complex adjustment layers, and they throw 25 adjustment layers on. I don't do that.
We don't spend much time in Photoshop. I mean, you do Photoshop only when you're doing the, you know, when you're taking out one of the soft boxes. Outside of that,
exactly,
you don't do a lot of
all
that.
My color grading is Lightroom.
Yeah,
true
too.
Creative profiles that I make in Photoshop, but then that's just, you know, you make them once, and then I will also determine, like the Mongolia images, I kind of determined like an overall look. I wanted to
sort
feel
of a
them
theme.
Yeah, like a LUT, basically, like they would grade a movie. So I'll decide on a grade for the a look for the entire series. And in this case, this was a little bit of the warm, desaturated look that you saw on the Eagle Hunter there. And then I'll create a profile for that. And then I just apply that profile to all the images, which is the beauty of Lightroom. And I only have to adjust some local adjustments, like brightening somebody's face or darkening a sky a little bit, but that's quickly done. And then I might throw on some luminar controls, because they have some cool structure controls and stuff, but that's it basically.
Okay. All right. Well, I've already flipped through. We probably need to start wrapping this up. We've been talking quite a long time. But I want to get through these Mongolia images. Not Mongolia, Ethiopia images.
Ethiopia.
Because one of the things I want to do is do a shout out, a commercial here. You and I both have a Mongolia workshop scheduled for, is it October?
Ethiopia.
I mean, you keep saying Mongolia, Ethiopia.
Yeah.
Which is
I just put it in the comments. Yeah.
Okay.
It's end of October. Yeah. 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 So, we have and I think Ethiopia has been on our bucket list for a very long time. And then we finally got to go twice already. First time was you and me together, because I was lucky to have been asked by Fujifilm Belgium to do a promotional video on the GFX50R. Mm-hmm. And then we went the second time last year with a group of people, and so we're going back. And I think that, as you can see from the images, that the people are there, and I tell that in the 50R video, they're some of the most beautiful people I've ever, and photogenic people I've ever mm-hmm. seen. And then if you combine that with the lighting, because there's no shortage, I think, of workshops in Ethiopia. Lord knows there's but we found when we were researching our own, but there's very few, if not none, that will
use a black backdrop,
do the amount of lighting exactly that will lug around a black backdrop, another backdrop. We have two backdrops, we have a bunch of heavy duty flashes, and that's what you need. This image, there's a, we have a behind the scenes of this somewhere, but this image is actually shot under a water tower at 12 noon in the bright, glaring Ethiopian sun. And I know it was bright and glaring because I was standing in the sun and I had a sunburn. Yet we made it look like it was shot in a studio, but there wasn't a studio to be found in an 800-mile radius from where we were. So, and that's what you can do with lights, and that's what we teach on this workshop. And I just love the people there, and
So, all right, well, let's look at this one. Is this the Brenizier technique
The Brenizier, not the Brenizier technique. That's a different technique. But the
Brenizier technique. I said Brenizier.
This is another thing I've been doing a lot, and this is one of my favorite shots of the first Ethiopia trip, because this is a village we visit on the workshop as well. This is the Omo Valley, and what you see in the background is the Omo River, and there's this one village which has this super photogenic location on a cliff right over the Omo River.
Well, and let's be honest, it's shot a lot.
It's shot a lot, but then again, the location, I haven't seen a lot of images like this, where we used flash and stuff.
Exactly.
And also, this is a special technique and I didn't invent this, by the way, but I like wide angle shots that show a lot of the environment, but I also like shallow depth of field. And so normally these two don't mix very well, because if you ever try to take like a wide angle shot, you know that you get more depth of field, and also there might be an 85 1.4 lens, but there are very few 50 millimeter 1.4 lenses out there. So what I do more and more these days is that I will just make a panorama with a portrait lens. And so this is a stitch from three photos. And it's not for the resolution, because this is shot on a GFX50, so I have plenty of resolution with a single shot. But this is just because this way I use a portrait lens, like an 85 millimeter, or in the GFX case, a 110 f2. I go a bit closer to my subject, which will immediately give me a shallower depth of field in the background, and then I just take a couple of shots left and right from them, and I will stitch them together. And so the result is an image with a kind of a surreal depth of field, or a shallowness of field, I should say, but still with a wider angle of view. And I really love that look. So I've been doing a lot of that lately, and we also practice that in our workshops.
Yeah, so this is the same technique.
This is the same technique. And so the funny thing is that here, there was this kid in the tree, and I actually only saw him when I was working on the shot.
Oh, that kid, you didn't put the kid up in the tree?
No, the kid was there already, and I only saw it afterwards. But or maybe I saw it when I was shooting. But I think I saw it when I was shooting, because I remember asking our assistant to also point the light at him for the last shot. But I didn't see him while I was starting the shot. It's only on the last that I saw it. And then I asked our assistant to aim the light at him as well, because the light has to be consistent if she's supposedly lit by the late evening or whatever, a little bit of setting sun, and then the boy in the tree has to have a similar light on him, which he has now. You don't see it very well because he's underexposed, but he has it, and it would look off if he didn't have it.
Okay. All right, we're gonna switch over here now. I believe this is Varanasi.
It is, yeah. And this is one where I played a little bit with color contrast. I put a gel on the flash. This is stuff I also explain. If people go to morethanwords.be/flash, you'll find a link to my flash book, and this is a case that I explain over there. This is basically this boy was actually wearing a white shirt, but I don't like white in my shots, especially at the edge of a shot, because it tends to draw the eye of the viewer out of the frame. So what I did here was, because I couldn't ask the kid to go back home and put on a blue shirt, I just shot our subject, who is lit by flash. I used an orange filter on the flash, which he doesn't need, because as you remember, the guy was orange enough as it was. But what happens is, if you make him too orange and then you correct for that in post, you add blue. So what happens is the extra blue that you add in post on the subject, which is the orange Sadhu, neutralizes his color, and so he gets to be the right amount of orange, and the extra blue on the boy with the white shirt makes the shirt turn blue. And so what you get is color contrast in an image, which is a really nice technique to draw attention to the subjects in your image.
Mm-hmm. Now, this one, I'm pretty sure you shot this after I left. I think you shot this with Vincent, didn't you?
I don't remember, because we've been shooting so many sadhus on boats.
Right. I just would remember the guy, because that guy's got a nose that it's hard to forget, and I don't.
Yeah, and exactly, and also
shooting.
And that's one of the fun things about the GFX again, because of the detail. Like he's got a wristband that says Ireland, and I only saw that afterwards, and I could take it out, but this is one of those things where I think, you know, it was there, and it's a fun contrast between, you know, this stoic, heroic looking pose and then the wristband that says Ireland. This is on in Varanasi, very stylized shot. And again, the processing, for example, on this one is literally, it's just one click on a creative profile, and that's boom, it's done.
Yeah. Now this one is underprocessed by your standards.
You should see the raw file.
Okay.
No, if one thing, I do tend to underexpose my images, and I don't know why that is exactly. It's probably because
you're not using a light meter.
Digital, well, maybe, but also it's because what I mainly look for is the right balance between the background and the foreground.
Right.
And very often, as you know, in very bright situations, even with the powerful flashes that we have, we often run our big flashes at full power, and sometimes they are still not powerful enough. So what I prefer is having the entire image underexposed, but having the balance between the flash and the background the way I want. Mm-hmm. Because that's something I can easily fix in Lightroom. I can add a stop of exposure and it will brighten everything, and then I'm good. But if the balance between the two is bad, say my background is well exposed, but my subject is too dark because the flash wasn't powerful enough, then I have a whole lot of local adjustment work in Lightroom. And it, honestly, the exposure, I've got shots, any modern camera these days has a leeway of at least, you know, 1 to 2 full stops in Lightroom, and the GFX has more like 3 or 4. So I just prefer to get the shot and then move on in this case.
Now, I was with you when we shot this. I have one almost identical.
Yeah, it's a super, super great.
So I'm gonna say something that is both a positive and a negative, not a negative about your work, but a positive and negative about workshops. Okay, so here's the thing, is that if someone wants to take a picture like this, they should come on our workshop. Okay, why? Because every picture that you've had, that you've shot here on a workshop setting, because the last two pictures besides this one, the other two prior ones weren't shot on a workshop. They were shot after the workshop, I think. But this one was shot on a workshop and then some others. And there is a high probability, I'm not going to say it's 100%, but there's a high probability that you can walk away with images that are almost identical, because we're working together, we're working on the lights, we've got it all set up, and we've got this guy standing there for us, acting like a model, basically, and yes, we do pay them for their time. And so that's a positive thing. So if you want to get a dramatic image like this with the amazing sky, because it was about ready to pour rain that day, and the wind had kicked up, and we almost got blown off the boat. But you want this image, like I have an image very similar to this. They're all going to have certain differences because they were taken at, you know, not at the same instant. Mm-hmm. But come on a workshop and you will get images like these, right? George is saying, I totally agree about your workshops. Now, the negative side of this is you're going to get an image just like this. And that's the thing that frustrates me sometimes as a workshop leader, is that we end up giving some of our best images away in a sense.
Mm-hmm. But that's the thing, I think, I know, and I know the feeling, but on the other hand, I think if you don't want that to happen,
don't
then
do
we
a
shouldn't teach work.
No, I know.
And there
no,
are
no.
people actually but the thing is, there are people who do workshops, but they, and we're not going to tell names or anything here, but I've heard reports of people taking workshops where that doesn't happen. So they're basically left to themselves and they have to just figure out everything by themselves. And I mean, in that case, I think you shouldn't do a workshop. It's the same, like I'm selling Lightroom presets and creative profiles, right? Which are the very same ones that I use in my own images. And I think that's only logical. But I have to be okay with the fact that sometimes I actually see images on Facebook that I think, hey, I don't remember shooting this. And that's because I didn't shoot it. It's somebody else who shot it and they bought my presets. And so their image looks like mine. But I have to be okay with that, because otherwise I shouldn't be selling presets, you know. But that's why I think what we sometimes do, like what we did in Kolkata, is we stayed on for a couple of days extra, and then it was just you and I shooting and getting some images for a video tutorial. And I think that's probably what I want to do more in the future, like a bit of both, so that you still get to build a little portfolio of your own while you're there, but you can also give your full attention to the workshop participants.
The point I was trying to make is that you will find that you are going to come on these workshops and you will be taking just as good images as Pete and I, you know, because we're working with you to make those images happen, you know? And so I think you won't be disappointed at all at what you end up getting. So this is a really, really, that's true. Wilbur Norman says they're not giving away the images, you're charging for your workshops. So fair enough.
Yeah,
that's true.
Well.
Yeah.
They're given away to the people who pay for the workshop.
Yeah. No, but I think we're using the word giveaway in the sense of not giving.
We're facilitating.
In other words, yeah. But anyway, this is a really, really interesting shot. And I was with you when you shot this. And this was an image that couldn't have been done without flash.
Mm-hmm.
Because the flash is what allowed those bubbles.
It's super close, first of all, and it's underexposed everything. So basically this is again shot at noon or 2 p.m. in Varanasi in super broad scorching daylight. And so what I did is I underexposed, because there's a lot of, if you know this street is like the super busy street with a lot of traffic and everything. So what I did is I underexposed that almost completely to turn it almost completely black. And then I, obviously my subject was underexposed too. And then I put the flash at the right side, a little bit behind him, pointing back at him. Mm-hmm. And so we get this super dramatic lighting.
But the bubbles are all backlit, right?
Yeah, and the bubbles are backlit, and that's what, you know, backlit light and backlit anything that, you know, that's translucent or semi-translucent and that's backlit, like clothing, or in this case, these bubbles, it'll look great on film or in same with steam.
But the reason the bubbles work is because you have that film from the soap. And that film is iridescent, and it changes colors. And so there you get all these different colors. It looks like you put a filter on it. I bet you've had a lot of people say, people are always asking you, did you do all this in post?
No, there's people who would do that, but I don't even know how to do it. But this is just, it's a lucky shot in a way that I didn't know it was going to turn out that cool and bright and colorful. But I had an idea. It's just an experiment, really, and because I remember we almost got into a fight with somebody. That's the thing in India. Sometimes there's always somebody who thinks they should.
It's everywhere. It's not just India.
Well, exactly. But there was a bystander all of a sudden trying to organize a shoot for us where we didn't really need any assistance, but people tried to anyway. And but before that, it was just an idea. Let's try this. I mean, and the result was very cool. Yeah.
Yeah. Renee says plenty of opportunities, though, to make your own image during your workshops. If we do,
and he knows, because he's about 5 trips away from a loyalty. The discount, yeah. I think, or 2 trips away from a loyalty discount. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And then the last one is this, and I've added a little bit of extra on that one.
Oh, how nice of you. Yeah. So if you want to know more about this, this is morethanwords.be. That's my site. You have, there's a, the first page right now is a COVID-19 disclaimer page telling me that my workshops have been canceled, but you can click through either to the sign up for the newsletter or the actual site where you see all the stuff that I was talking about. But this is, yeah, this is, the funny thing is that this is shot with the, I think that the GFX 50 or 100, I should look it up in my EXIF info, but this is, some people say that these cameras aren't good for
they're not good for action
shots. Yeah, whereas I mean they work great for me. And it's just, this is a, because in this case I just pre-focused, you know, and I'm trying to find which, I think it's the 50. Let me check.
Well, I think I was with you. And it's either the 50R or the 50S. And so either one of them, they focus the same.
It's the 50S. It's the 50S. Yeah. So, and maybe just, you know, to, I can quickly just, this is an image I edited entirely in Lightroom. So maybe I can, because we promised we'd do that. So just to wrap this off, or wrap this up rather. So as you can see,
you might want to move your face to the other side of the screen. The Skype logo is right on top of your, you, in other words, your picture in picture.
Here?
Your pic, yeah. Oh, like you just ran across the screen. That's great. Yeah.
Yeah. Ooh, woo, woo, woo. Yeah. Okay. So this one here is, so as you can see what I did to this image, let me do a virtual copy. Oh, here is the, so no, this is the black and white. So I'm going to do a virtual copy and I'm going to reset that. So this is the original image, right? Mm-hmm. So basically what I did, I mean, the perspective wasn't, so I straightened it, then I straightened the horizon and I cropped it because I wanted to look a bit more cinematographic. So I think I did a 16:9 crop of it, or even, this is more than 16:9. I think it's probably a 2:1 crop anyway. And then most of it, like you see here, so this is the way it looks by default in Lightroom. Mm-hmm. Well, not by default. I mean, this is the image without
the
color
file.
Grading. That's the raw file. Yeah, that's not the raw file. I mean, this is the original raw file, right? No, so this is the original raw file.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Then this is the raw file with basic panel edits on it. So.
Right.
I upped the exposure a bit, the contrast, took the highlights down a bit, increased the shadows, the whites and the blacks a little bit, added some clarity, a little bit of a tone curve. But
right.
You see, all the rest is at the defaults. This is default sharpening, default, not default noise reduction. I added a bit of noise reduction. But other than that, I mean, no vignetting, no HSL adjustments.
Okay.
It's the same color. That's what I mean. The same. And then what I did is I just added a color grade to it through a profile. So the difference you saw between just seconds ago and this final image is a creative profile called Moody Browns in this case. And the and basically that creative profile under the hood applies a whole truckload of adjustments. But the nice thing is that it's not a preset, because if I would add a preset to that, this might mess with some of my slides that I already changed, right? Mm-hmm. If the preset, for example, has shadows plus 10 and I have dialed in shadows plus 28 here, or plus 26, I can't read it exactly, then instead of adding shadows, it would, you know, make my image darker again, Whereas a creative profile is cumulative to whatever you've already done on your image. And also the creative profiles have this slider here, the amount slider. So the default was this, 100. But if I like the effect, but I think it's too much, I can just dial it down. So this is zero of the profile. And you see, I can build it up just by dragging a slider, and it all scales under the hood. Everything scales
so
proportionally.
Go past 100. What does it do then?
Oh, it intensifies the look.
Okay.
You see? Mm-hmm. But I rarely go past it, but you could if you, I mean, it just extrapolates, if that's a word, everything. But in this case, I decided on 90. And that's the cool thing with these creative profiles. Like, if I want another one, like in this case, for example, you see, the other image of the sadhu on the boat, I remember using this one, faded colors. And again, if it's too strong, you can dial it back a bit. And that's why I love these creative profiles so much. And that's why I don't mind paying Adobe $10 a month for the fact that I can use this. There's some black and white ones. Anyway, so okay. These are on my website if people are interested. But that's just, so it might look like I put in a lot of work, but it's not always the case, luckily.
All right. Well, good. So we got to be able to work on that as well. And so now you can maybe pop out of your screen so we can see you.
Yeah.
Oh, that's not going to work.
wait. Where am I? I have
I
too many
buttons.
I don't know,
but you've got complete control of everything here. All right. Here we go. Good. 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 All right. So... well, I think we're going to wrap it up, Pete. I think it's been super, super
We can go on
fun.
For days, folks. So,
well, we can, but we don't need to. So we've already done a two-hour. This is the longest one we've ever done. So we didn't even get to talk about other gear. You and I we used to do a podcast after every workshop where we talk about all the new gear we use, things like that. We'll have to come back and do that because that's always fun to do.
Mm-hmm.
And
sure.
So, all right. Well, so just in closing up again, you can go to Pete's website, and that is, let me see if I can pull that up real quick again.
morethanwords.be.
Right.
Yeah.
morethanwords.be. And let's see. Here it is right here. Oops. There it is. morethanwords.be. And BE is the Belgian, sort of the .com, whatever you call that for Belgium. But that's morethanwords.be. So and so again, thanks Pete for coming. And if when they get there, they get to your website, they'll be able to sign up for your newsletter. You send out a newsletter.
Yeah.
They get what do they get when they sign up for your newsletter?
They well basically they what they get 10 not profiles, but they get the 10 looks that you saw in the profiles. They get them as presets. So like the Moody Browns look, mm-hmm. they get a pack of 10 presets for Lightroom and just by signing up. It's morethanwords.be/newsletter.
Okay. And then you've got video trainings on your website. You've got video courses that you sell. You've got all the books, everything.
Next week, the Love Grove event, mm-hmm. morethanwords.be/deconstructed. And that's going to be fun. And and I even have the workshop with you in Ethiopia. Mm-hmm. That's also on there, morethanwords.be/Ethiopia.
Okay.
And plenty of stuff.
All right. So that's that. And then I want to remind people to go to my website, thedigitaltrekker.com, and sign up for my ebook and get on so that you know the next time we're going to be talking with Pete again and you can be a part of that one. Thanks for unboxing your camera. Have fun with it this week.
Now I have to put it back in.
Why do you have to put it back in?
Yeah. Well, because I want to do another unboxing video myself. No, I'm joking. I have to buy a second one to be able to do another unboxing.
All right. Well, anyway, so thank you, everybody, for joining us. It's late here. It's midnight our time here. And tell Ruth and your son I said, hey, and we will be talking soon. And stick around. We've got this week, Friday, again, I'll be doing a special workshop, actually, with Fujifilm Malaysia. And be looking, if you sign up for my newsletter, you'll know when that is. And then we've got some interviews scheduled for next week as well. So thank you, everybody. Thank you, Pete. All have a great night. Bye-bye.
Bye.